Hi everyone and welcome back to the series of videos dedicated to computers from the early 2000s. Today we're going to be looking at the ABIT IC7 MAX3. And we're going to start with some close-ups. Next is the assembly, and we're going to use the same components we used in the AMD Athlon build. For this build, we're going to use a Pentium 4 3.2 GHz Northwood CPU. The rest of the components will be the same as in the AMD Athlon build, with the same Corsair RAM, the same 4400 NVIDIA GeForce 4 video card, and the Western Digital 80 gig hard drive. This motherboard, just like the AN7, has some angled IDE connectors that really help with the cable management. And now the BIOS. The soft menu setup option allows us to define the CPU parameters and the voltages. Fortunately, if you're going to increase the FSB, there's a fixed ratio between the AGP and the PCI frequencies. We're going to disable the hyper-threading just to make it a fair fight with the AMD. We're going to come back to this option and run some tests with the hyper-threading enabled. On the chipset features, we're going to set the timings for the RAM. For which I discovered that it can do 2225, given I provide it with the increased voltage it requires. And we're going to disable some devices that are not necessary for this session. The PC health status allows us to specify the OATS fan speed or to disable it. Next, we're going to look at some information about the system and then proceed with the tests. And we're going to start with PCMark 2002. And continue with the 1 megabyte calculation of pi. Next, we're going to do the tests from Sandra, and we're going to compare it to similar processors from the era. In case you've missed it in the information, the Pentium 4 has some extra instructions, the SSE2, that sets it apart from the AMD. And this set of instructions make the Pentium 4 a bit more modern than the AMD Athlon XP. Cinebench 2003 is next. This is CPU mark, and we're going to compare it to the processors it has stored in its database. CacheMem will show us the speed of the cache. Next, we're going to use LAME to encode to the highest quality a WAV file of 78 megabytes and get the time for benchmark reference. View spec performance is next, and we're only going to run the DirectX 8 test. And now we're going to run the 3DMark 2001 followed by the Aquamark 3 benchmark. The next test is going to be code creatures. The next benchmark we're going to see is X2 the threat, and we're going to see the rolling demo. And now we're back to the usual graphics tests. It's Comanche 4 followed by Unreal Tournament 2003 benchmark. Most of the games that use the Quake engine include a demo in the files. And obviously we're gonna start with Quake Free Arena. Serious Sam includes its own benchmark, and we're gonna see Sierra del Chapas. And we're back with some more Quake engine games. First we're gonna see Return to Castle Wolfenstein, followed by Jedi Outcast. Finally, we're gonna look at the Far Cry benchmark. Next, we're gonna look at some OpenGL games, but we're gonna start with the DirectX version of Village and continue with the OpenGL version of Village just to make a comparison between the two. Next, we're going to look at MDK, TreeMark, SphereMark, all of them being OpenGL benchmarks. And now we're going to repeat some of the tests we've done before using the OpenGL driver. And we're going to start with Sirius Sam, Sierra del Chiapas demo, and we're going to follow it with Return to Castle Wolfenstein checkpoint demo. We're gonna try to overclock the CPU. I tried overclocking the CPU, but unfortunately it's either the power supply unit that's not providing enough juice, or the motherboard is getting a bit old, or the CPU itself is not able to increase its frequency too much. It's time now for some games, and we're gonna start with Need for Speed Underground. This is Serious Sam, and it doesn't need any more introduction. The last game we're gonna look at today is Return to Castle Wolfenstein. Overall, I really like the looks of IC7 and how modern it feels with the angled IDE connectors that help with cable management and with the ditching of the serial and parallel connectors on the back. ABIT has clearly positioned this enthusiast's board with overclocking in mind. Unfortunately today the IC7 wasn't able to overclock the CPU too much due to unknown factors, but at least we got the chance to run a series of tests on the stock settings, and in the next video, after comparing it with another Intel motherboard, we're gonna compare all the results to the ones we have from the AMD boards. Thank you and see you next time. After the review of the IC7 and the 3.2 GHz Pentium 4 CPU, I was disappointed in the overclocking potential of the CPU or board, so I decided to check another CPU. Luckily I found the Pentium 4 at 2.4 GHz in my CPU box and decided to go for it. I started with 220 FSB on first boot. If I couldn't do at least this, there was no point in continuing. And I kept on adding 200 MHz to the CPU on every reset. Once I got past 3 GHz, I only added 100 MHz every reset. When reaching 270 FSB, I concluded that maybe some of the silicon chips were equal. This CPU could probably reach even an even higher frequency than the overclocked 3.2 GHz CPU, but I was pushing it over 270 FSB on a 20-year-old motherboard that has seen some good use in its days. Searching for reviews from the 2000s, somebody stated that he wants a guarantee for stability past 250 FSB. But reaching this level almost 20 years is a solid testament of the potential endurance and quality and guarantees these boards offer. I must conclude that I'm almost envious of the people that used this board and exploited its full potential back in the day. Thank you.